First off, Alex, why did you want to take on this subject matter with a film?
Well, honestly, I read Larry's book, and it was very powerful. It had a very powerful effect on me. But I thought in a film what I could do is to give the emotional sense of what it's like to be inside the church. And so that's what I tried to do.
And Lawrence, you say in the film, you say that you weren't out to try to do an expose right. with your book. But do you feel like it turned into that?
Well, they can accept it one way or another, but my goal was to understand it. It's not just Scientology. If you understand what happens in Scientology, how really idealistic good people can be led into doing things they never imagined, then you can understand a lot about other religions and political movements.
Right, and a lot of that was a part of the film, taking a look at this fight, this war that they called it, of being seen as a religion. That battle right there, do you think that pretty much set the tone for how the Church of Scientology would move forward from that point on? Because it changed the game for them when they won that.
It's essential to their business. I mean, what you're talking about is how they fought tooth and nail to get their IRS exemption, to be treated as a religion. And that's what allows them to have enormous power and money, because all of their revenues are tax exempt and they buy a lot of real estate. It's tax free, so it allows them to achieve their power.
Do you think that this film would have been able to be done if such high members, high ranking members of the church hadn't left?
It would have been very hard to do. And I think what's important about the film is that you see these high ranking people not only today talking about what happened, but you see them essentially acting as enforcers for the church back in the day and actively lying about things. And so to see how they used to treat critics of the church when they were in, and then to get their reflections on how traumatic that is for them to understand that today, that goes to Larry's point about the prison of belief.
I think we should underscore how courageous they were to speak out. Because,
absolutely.
You know, they, even to today, even to yesterday, when some of them arrived at the airport, they were greeted with private investigators and videoing them. The harassment continues.
So let's talk about some of those big names that are members of the church, mainly John Travolta and Tom Cruise. And you take a look at both of their situations. With Tom Cruise, there's a lot. Basically, the claim is that the Church of Scientology played a role in breaking up Tom and Nicole Kidman. Do you believe that that was an active process that they were doing?
I do. I do believe that. And I think we have pretty good testimony from church insiders who back that up.
What's interesting to me is that there was no mention of Katie Holmes. Why is that?
You know, we could have done a six-hour miniseries on this. So we focused on certain areas and certain characters. We focused on a small number, and I think we got the story that we wanted.
I hear there were more than 100 lawyers that worked to vet this on the process to get it to where it is today. How tedious of a process, and maybe this is even while you were writing it as well, how tedious of a process was it to get this process, the story told, when you know that you have to go through that many lawyer steps?
Well, the quote from Sheila Nevins from HBO was that there were 160 lawyers. I think that was a kind of off-the-cuff statement. It's what they say, a fact too good to be checked.
Yeah.
And I think that really wasn't so. But it went through a pretty thorough legal review, and we're pretty confident that we're buttoned up.
It's all covered up. Do you ever worry for either of you? Do you ever feel that there's danger for either of you tackling the story?
Not compared to what these people have experienced. You know, we've gotten legal threats, going all the way back to a New Yorker story that I wrote, you know, tons of legal threats, but they've never followed through on any of that. But the kind of harassment that former members have had to endure and still are enduring, we've never experienced anything like that.
You saw the film and you know that, you know, in the case of Marty Rathman, for example, the guy who's the number two person in the church, they had cameras in a house right across from his, surveilling him constantly.
Even after he left the church. And it's fascinating to watch, and it's definitely something that everyone's going to be talking about, because no one has that insight into the picture. Thanks so much.
It's been a pleasure.